sanitizing for your protection. All right, tonight we are going to do the art of cinematography. And the cinematographer, or the director of photography, is in charge of, well, let's talk about what they're in charge of. They work closely with the director. Their main function, remember, of the director is to direct the actors, right? Block their movements or tell them where to go, where to stand, how to walk, where to walk. Not necessarily how to walk, but where to walk. Where to stand, where to deliver their lines, how to deliver their lines, blah, 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 the continuity of the script. All right, that's the director's job. Remember that from week 5. The main function of the DP and his or her crew is to capture the actors and the action and do whatever the director needs or wants to get them to capture the action that tells the story, all right? And since film is a visual medium, the director of photography is really a pretty important job since it's, well, it's a visual and audible medium, but for our purposes today, we're going to talk about the visual medium or the visual part of the filmmaking process. So, because you've heard that adage of picture is worth a thousand words, well, in the case of cinema, which is the visual medium of cinema and television, YouTube, and blah blah, the DP or the director of photography, the cinematographer, is a key role because they're responsible for the visuals, what you see as the story is unfolding. All right, picture's worth a thousand words. Let's start with a little short film. All right, cute little story. Little slice of life human drama that reminds us the how powerful the medium of film can be. I mean, this is, you know, like a 5-minute movie with no dialogue, just effects and music. But how poignant a little story it can be. The visual medium, right? Cinematography. Let's keep going. All right, so let's talk about the director of photography's toolkit, or cinematographer's toolkit. Pretty vast and varied. We'll start with the actual capturing device, which is the camera. We'll go talk a little bit about lens and film stock and the digital medium as well. There's lighting and grip. Lighting is the department that creates light, and grip is the department that typically takes light away. Not gesticulating that right. And they're also the department that actually is in charge of moving the camera, to change the perspective of what the viewer is supposed to see. And finally, you need a staff. So that's the toolkit for the director of photography. All right, let's dig in. The camera, it's pretty basic. You know, your films are being shot. I think that last Apple phone ad, they were saying, you know, shoot your film on an iPhone because it's a 4K quality. It's pretty amazing stuff. You don't need a professional camera anymore. Not that you ever did, but you don't need a professional camera. You don't need to spend a whole bunch of money anymore. Just your phone can be your camera. You do have to pick a medium. Well, you did, you know, 10 years ago. Nowadays, it's pretty much all digital. But in the olden days, such an old man, you did have to choose it between film and digital format. Although, and I say that in joking, that, you know, no one shoots on film anymore, but lately there have been a rash of filmmakers who have chosen to go back to the old format of film because they wanted the control, they wanted the look and the feel that film, celluloid, the actual celluloid would give you, would give them as a filmmaker, as opposed to the clean digital image. As opposed, you know, they wanted to shoot film as opposed to shooting digital clean and then dirtying up to make it look dirty. A really good case in point is Tarantino's Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. Now, he's, you know, a cinemaphile that goes way back. He has studied the art of filmmaking and the art of cinema and the art of the actual process of it. So for Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, you know, it's a period film. It takes place in the 70s in Los Angeles. So he wanted to feel and look. So instead of shooting with digital, which would make a nice clean image, and dirtying it up to make it feel like an old film, he decided to go back and shoot on 35mm film. So I say that you have to choose it. And filmmakers still are nowadays still making that choice, whether they shoot on digital or film. So other than the camera, you need a lens, something to channel the light, the image into, whether you're channel it onto a piece of celluloid or you channel it onto a sensor, which captures the image, you need a lens. We're going to talk about the zoom lenses, right, and all the different types of lenses that the director of photography has to choose from. And then support, something has to hold the camera up for whatever shot you want to get. All right, so a little bit on lenses. Not going to get too technical, but it's measured in millimeters. So whenever you're calling out for a lens, you are telling it what millimeter size. Millimeter is the size of the lens. There's the speed or the aperture, meaning that how wide or how small the aperture gets. You know, just like your eye, your actual eyeball. When you're in a dark theater, your aperture, your eyeball opens up big, so you can let a lot of light in, right? This is nature. And when you go outside to the bright sunlight, it goes down again because you don't need to have as much an opening to get the same amount of light in so you can see, you know, walk to your car or whatever. So the aperture has to do with the speed of the lens, how fast the lens is. We'll talk about that in a little bit. Focal length includes magnification and angle of view. Magnification just meaning there's this little image shows what size lenses there are and how much of the image you get to see based on that size of the lens. So a lot of time the lens selection for the DP is based on what he wants you to see in the frame. Zoom lenses are basically a lens that it's more than one lens. So you can actually change the focal length of the lens for a zoom lens. And telephoto lenses tend to be long lenses, whereas you can be far away from a subject and bring them in close to the viewer's eye. And then wide angle is basically self-explanatory. You want to see more of the image, more of what the, I want to see the entire house and not just the window of it. I'll use a wide angle lens, but if I just want to see a window, I'll use a telephoto. And if I want to start seeing the whole house and then zoom and then end up on a shot of the window, then I would use a zoom lens. So boom, 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 all three of those lenses, real simple. Telephoto lenses, these could also be zoom lenses as well. You tend to be really big, right? Because you have to have more elements, the glass elements in the lens, and they also have to let a lot of light in, because look how much the direction, how much distance the light has to travel to get through from one end of the lens to the camera itself. You see a lot of sports photographers use this because, they can't really be on the playing field, so they're on the sidelines, but they want to zoom in and get a close-up of Tom Brady, as he's about to throw his next next touchdown pass, not for the Patriots anymore. So you see a lot of this in sports photography, a lot of these telephoto lenses. As far as lens selection for a director of photography, this is a really good example. All these shots were shot at the same place from the same angle of the same building, but they just chose a different lens for it. So take the one on the left. If you want to just shoot the entrance to this church, cathedral, whatever it is, and you want to be able to see, who the faces of the people walking out, you would choose the left on the lens. But if the building itself, and maybe a little bit of sky and the ground, was more important to the shot, you didn't necessarily care to see details on the person walking out of that or into that cathedral church, you would choose a wider lens. Same thing with all the other examples. It would just, the DP has to decide. Usually the director is deciding as well, but the DP will be able to tell, okay, in this shot, I think the person is important, so let's use a longer lens or a telephoto lens to get just the entrance. Whereas the director might say, no, it's important we see the whole cathedral. I understand the script better than you do, so I'm going to decide it. Or a lot of times you may say, let's shoot it both ways and let the editor decide. But this is the realm of the DP and the camera department to help the director to bring his vision of what the script is, what the story is, what the shot should be. Okay, so pretty good. Wide-angle lenses are an amazing thing, but you have to be careful using them because they can distort an image. There's something called the fisheye lens, and they call it a fisheye because, if you ever caught a fish and looked at its eye, it's really bulbous, right? And really, really kind of. So that's what a fisheye lens looks like. The outer glass is really heavily curved, which gives you that distortion effect. So you see a 8mm fisheye versus an 8mm wide-angle lens. You see how much more of that balcony you get with a fisheye, but look how distorted it does, the distortion it does to the image. So you would only use a fisheye lens if you were looking to distort the image. If you're looking for, someone woke up from a drug-induced haze or someone's, high and the image, or someone's having a flashback. I mean, there's all kinds of reasons why the director would want to tell the DP or ask the DP, use a fisheye, or I want to see what it looks like. But the DP would put it on the lens and put it on the camera and show the director. The director would say, all right, that's way too distorted. Go back to the regular 8mm wide or the director may just leave it up to the DP and say, it's up to you. You know the scene. Pick the image you want. And it doesn't happen very often, but it does happen. All right, so that's the difference between just a wide-angle lens and a fisheye. You can see the fisheye really distorts it. All right, so focal length equals lens choice. You're saying, well, what's the difference, Mr. Kyle? Why do I need another difference? Well, this is a pretty good, these two clips I'm going to show are a pretty good example. So this is a 135mm lens, 135mm. It's a longer lens. It's a kind of a telephoto lens. But we kind of see what the model would look like at 135mm. These are all shot from the same angle. So we go to a little wider lens, 100mm, not as telephoto, and we step through until I think we get to wide-angle lens. So you're starting to see a little distortion in her image here, right? She's starting to look a little bit different from the 135 to a 50. Oh, what are you noticing? Yeah, she's not nearly as attractive, right? Her face is starting to widen out. Her features are starting to widen out. To a 50 millimeter. Okay, I think we're gonna go, well, we're gonna go wider to a 35. And now you're starting to see some real distortion. A 35 millimeter lens isn't a very wide lens, but it's wider than 135 millimeter, meaning that you see more. So what's happening is the lens is starting to curve more as we get to a wider angle. And as the lens curves, you see that her face, the model's face distorts. Until we get to the widest lens in this scene, which is a 20 millimeter lens, and you see the distortion factor of the 20, and I think they're going to do a comparison between 135, there's 135, right? Same distance from the model, and we step through to wider and wider lenses, or shorter and shorter lenses. As we get to the shortest lens, we see the distortion. So these are the things that the DP needs to know. Directors need to know this as well, so they can, you know, tell the DP what they're kind of looking for in a shot. But DPs need to know this. If the director says, oh, I'll just throw a 20 millimeter on, the DP has to say, did you not go to film school? Do you not remember what a 20 millimeter lens does? And the director would say, oh yeah, okay, you're right. But these are the things the DP has to know. Now, if the DP has read the script ahead of time, which they should, and know that this is supposed to be a distorted image, or the scene is supposed to be distorted, then they would automatically go with a wider lens. I think there's another clip. Shows you. Yeah, all right, so we start at 200 millimeter, which is a lot longer lens. What happens with these longer lenses is you have a short distance that of things that could be in focus. So notice that she's perfectly in focus, but the things in the background are really blurry, right? Which is good. We want the things in the background to be blurry because we don't necessarily want to see all the stuff that's happening in the background. We just wanted to see her, the model. But as we go to a wider and wider lens, the focal plane, or the area that's in focus, increases. So now we can start seeing the stuff in the back. We can see a chair, we can see some stuff in the background, it's starting to become clearer, it's distracting, right? It's taken away from her, and you notice that her face is actually starting to widen out as well. Now look, at this length lens, we can see all the stuff in the background, 35 millimeter, everything is starting to become in focus. We can see his light stand on the back, we can see a flag in the back. 25 millimeter, all the junk. We know that she's not, you know, on a stage anymore. We can tell that she's in a setting that's been dressed. We can see a light stand back there. Not good. All right, so these are the things that the DP needs to understand. What the lens choice, or the focal length of the lens, will do for the image, and how it will affect the image, and how it will affect what the image is, what the viewer sees. Okay, and you notice how distorted she is. Now again, all those photos were taken from the same location. They didn't move the physical camera at all. They just put different lenses on, and the lenses got longer, wider, and wider, wider. So it looks like she's closer, and because she's closer, everything in the background is in focus. Not a good choice. Let's go with the long lens on these. All right, so that's the camera, and that's the lens. So the next thing in their toolkit is the lighting and grip package. Remember, lighting and grip, you're basically just creating shadows. Or you're not creating shadows. But the lighting and grip department is also in charge of moving the camera. Tripod systems, tripod called because there's three legs. There's all kinds of things, systems set up that you can rent, that you can buy, that you can make, that support the camera to help you do all these amazing types of shots. And we'll look at some of these shots. Finally, jib arms and cranes. All right, so this is your basic dolly, right? It's got four wheels, and they're usually rubber wheels, so they are a lot smoother, on whatever surface you can think of. There's a wide, flat surface here to mount the camera, and so maybe a camera operator can actually ride on the dolly with them. Two handles here, one that actually is a sturdy handle that you can push and pull the dolly with. The other one actually is a steering mechanism, so you can steer the wheels like an actual car. This dolly is mounted on these little a mini dolly, basically, which are urethane skateboard wheels, and they're canted inward, so they will ride on this metal rail, this very heavy metal rail, and that gives you a nice smooth shot. Because if you were to put the camera on this dolly and run it up and down the sidewalk, you notice that there are bumps and cracks in the sidewalk, and you would feel every one of those, and you'd see the camera shake a little bit. Therefore, if you want a nice smooth shot, you would actually put these tracks down, or these rails, mount the dolly onto these mini dollies, which rod on this rails, and you get a nice smooth shot. Put a little baby powder on there and very smooth. All right, so that's your basically your basic dolly. This one's called a doorway dolly because these little planks come off, and then you'll be able to actually fit it through a standard American doorway. But if you don't need to worry about fitting through a doorway, you put these sideboards on and you can fit a much bigger unit. You can actually fit people on there. And the person that actually is running the dolly, moving it back and forth, is called the dolly grip. Yeah, that's a specific job. A grip can't be a dolly grip. Dolly grip is its own position. All right, so that's your basic doorway dolly. You take the doorway dolly, you add a hydraulic arm to it, which can actually move the camera up and down, ped it up and down, very nice little ped shots, and it becomes a pedestal dolly. All right, this is a Chapman Mini. I'm not sure which one this is, but you'll see you can mount a full-size camera onto it. There's a little chair here, sometimes there's two, for a camera operator and assistant camera operator to ride on the dolly. The dolly grip would hold the handles back here, and they also have the control to crab all the wheels one way, so you can turn all four wheels one way and move it that way. These wheels have a gap in between the two, so you can actually mount this on a rail system without having to mount it on a mini dolly. They have a control here to pedestal using hydraulics to have the camera go up smoothly and go down smoothly, and the camera operator would be able to move the camera whichever they want. There's little, you can stick sideboards on these as well, so you can have more people on theirs. But you know, these dollies are all steel with the hydraulics. They're very heavy. Usually takes, you know, four hefty people or grips to pick it up and lift it down. So it may look very small, but it's very, very heavy duty piece of equipment. You also have these risers on it, so you can actually mount the camera really low to the ground, or you can put the risers on it to mount it a lot higher than the actual dolly would go. But this is your basic standard mini dolly. You go a little bit bigger in size. This is a Chapman dolly made by the Chapman Corporation. These, you would see them more. I mean, they're very heavy, but you see the rubber wheels, or they're actually inflated wheels, and you see the gap here that it would put on a track. You have a dolly grip here. See, he's crabbing all four wheels in one direction. You can also turn it off, so only one side moves. Pretty amazing. There is the big pedestal movement, which is hydraulics. So basically, there's a hydraulic system in here, just like, you know, your low rider car, those of you from East LA. And you have this air hydraulic systems. You pump it with air, and then this thing rides you up and down based on a valving system. Very smooth. It's not jerky at all. There's a riser on it to bring it up. You see the camera operator, and then there used to be a seat over here for an assistant camera operator. And that's your basic dolly. All right, you can also mount these things called jib arms onto dollies or onto tripods, rolling tripods as well. Jib arms give you the ability to raise and lower the camera or on axes that you wouldn't be able to get just if you're on a standard dolly. You can mount a jib arm to a standard dolly, and then, you know, you can go do these great, you know, rising shots or lowering shots down to the ground, or sweeping pans or vistas, because a camera operator does not need to be at the end of these. The camera operator will be somewhere off screen, usually with a tether connecting the camera to a little monitor, and they're watching that monitor. Whether wireless or not wireless. This is called a jib arm. And I think those of you who have sailors, or not sailors, but boatsmen or yachtsmen, yachts people, know what a jib arm on a sailboat is. And I think that's probably where this got its name, the jib arm. Jib arms come in all different sizes. Gee, this is a mega jib arm. The camera is mounted down here, and again, it's either remote or there's a cable that runs to a monitor, so the director and the DP can actually see what's going, what the camera is capturing. You see, these are nice and big, but also you can mount this on rails as well, right? Because if you wanted to have the shot of the dolly moving over, the grass would be bumpy. There's no way you get it smooth. You couldn't get it over this hump right here, so you throw some wood down there. You put track on there. You put the dolly on the track, and you can go in and out, nice and smooth. You see there are two operators back here pushing the jib arm and the dolly, so they're both dolly grips. And this fella, I don't know, this fella might just be an extra grip. This is counterbalance, so you have weights back here. You notice that this part of the arm is a lot longer than this part, so there are weights back here to counterbalance the weight of the camera. So basically, this jib arm, it just floats, right? It's not like a teeter-totter. It's, you know, if you take one off, it's not going to go like that. It's counterbalanced perfectly, so it floats. Jib arm mounted on a tripod dolly. Jib arms come in all sizes based on, you know, how high in the sky you want to go, or how low to the ground you want to go, or how far away from the object you are. A lot of times, any film, behind the scene film you watch, there's going to be, you know, one of these jib arm shots in there, because they're very impressive.
Barrooms left by those who came before. They say we gotta want it more.
When I first saw that shot, I was really wondering how they did it. And I had all kinds of theories, thinking, okay, it was a Steadicam, or it was a drone, or it was a jib arm. And it turned out it was a jib arm, a really long jib arm that could go from one side of the road all the way to the other, could go in between the cars, do close-ups of the person in the cars, and go high up into the air. You could do that now with a drone, I think, but they did it old-fashioned way. They did it with a jib arm. Pretty astounding shot. All right, let's go on to camera support. So camera support is basically whatever I think is available. If you can afford to get tripods and all kinds of devices that I have listed here, then that's fine. But basically, it's whatever is available. If it's a shoulder, or if it's a sandbag, or if it's a box, something just to steady the camera to get your shot. Unless you don't want it to be steady, you want it to be shaky, then there are ways to make it shaky as well, other than, you know, just having someone shake the camera. You're always going to get, if you're handheld, you're always going to get the camera operator breathing, because, you know, we're not robots, we're human, so you're going to see the camera move, which is why we have stabilizers, and they've invented all kinds of things that keep the camera steady. Handheld devices, I'm going to show you examples of all these in a second. Tripods, meaning it has three legs. Monopods, a single leg. Dollies are basically anything with wheels. In old film school days, we use wheelchairs because they were nice and smooth, and you can sit in it with the camera, and someone could pull and push you around and turn you around and flip you and do things. Shopping carts. sat in a lot of shopping carts my day. Anything with wheels, basically. Skateboards are good as well. Bicycles, anything with wheels. Counterbalance stabilizers, I'll show you those in a second. And the jib arms, which is what we just looked at. All right, so here's some examples. This is called a rail. So basically, the camera sits on a little dinghy that mounts into the rail. The camera can slide back and forth very smoothly for tabletop shots, or if you don't, you know, have a big budget, or you don't have room to bring a big dolly in there with wheels, you can get one of these, set it up on a tabletop or on the floor or any level or non-level surface, even two tripods, at the end of two tripods, and the camera can slide really nicely. They get these really professional looking moving shots. This is one of those counterbalance doohickeys that I told you about. This one's called a Steadicam, which is the name brand for this particular one is Steadicam, but other companies have made counterbalance stabilizers or gyro stabilizers or weight balance stabilizers. This one was invented and marketed by a company called Steadicam. If you want to be a Steadicam operator, you look in the end credits of every film nowadays, there's going to be a Steadicam operator. These are operators that invest in one of these Steadicam rigs or a camera. They get to use it very well. Then they hire on like mercenaries, as hired guns onto shows, because most shows aren't shot entirely with a Steadicam. Usually they're just brought in for 1 or 2 days for, you know, shots where they particularly need them. So another entry into the film industry. If you want to invest in a Steadicam and learn how to do it well, you can work a day here, a day there, a day here, a couple days here, and make your living as a Steadicam operator. Since the industry has made little small portable ones that you can use for your own home video, pretty neat. It's got a little gimbal, a little ball gimbal on top of the hand, and it's counterweighted at the very end. So you can change the weight depending on what camera you have. And just walk along, and it absorbs the shakiness of your walking or running or whatever you're doing, dancing. And they're relatively inexpensive, and you can get them for just about any size camera you can think of. Pretty neat. Segment that popped up 10 years ago that the sports or the action cameras led by GoPro, but you know there are a lot of knockoffs and smaller ones now, but GoPro, because they're so small and you know now they're shooting really high resolution, audio is not necessarily the strength of these cameras, but you know when you're going down the side of a mountain or going underwater or jumping off a cliff or even skydiving from a satellite, the action camera segment has changed how amateur filmmakers can get professional looking products as well. And I mentioned earlier the drones are an amazing new segment that popped up and become popularized now that the FFA has kind of figured out what kind of rules and regulations, what kind of training, what kind of licensing you need to operate these drones. But they've pretty much leveled off now. You just got to get a license. I think I have a license back here somewhere. You stick the sticker on your drone and you can operate it up to a certain amount of feet, a certain distance. I think you have to have line of sight. You can't let your drone disappear from you. But the invention and marketing of the Phantom, the DJI line, has basically changed how the market has responded. And now, you know, anyone can buy a drone and anyone can get really good 2K, 4K footage for their film projects. It's just a new way to support the camera. You don't have to, you know, rent a helicopter or an airplane anymore. You can actually get all the footage you need with a drone.
Looks good.
Okay, if found, return to Sam Gorski.
So it looked pretty cool.
Belongs to you.
My camera. Oh man, my yard. Oh, dang it. Superman.
Okay, so that short film was made by some YouTubers a couple years back. Basically, it just shot against the green screen, or shot the Superman and all the actors in front of green screen, like the one I'm standing in front of, shooting this one. And they got their Phantom, and they went and shot some footage in Los Angeles and cut it all together. And it's a great little clip showing, you know, demonstrating how just amateurs, basically, people who aren't professionals, they've since gone on to be professionals, but just get a drone, get a camera, get some actors, green screen, and make a really great little video and get, you know, millions of views on YouTube. Pretty neat little clip. All right, so let's run through our director of photography's toolkit again. We start with the camera, went to lighting and grip, and crew. Let's talk about the director of photography's crew. All right, so light and grip hierarchy. All right, so the director of photography or cinematographer is in charge of the visual look. You know, the production designer brings in the props, brings in the setting, and the director brings in the actors. But it's a director of photography who's in charge of making sure that the images that are captured, the performances are captured, the backgrounds, everything is captured is what the director wants to tell the story. So underneath the DP, we have the gaffer, who is the main lighting person, the person in charge of the chief in charge of all the lighting. That includes the people who are working for them and him or her, and includes the equipment as well. So the person who is in charge of the equipment is usually called the best boy. Best boy can be a girl. It's just an old Hollywood term. But basically, they're in charge of the equipment. All right? They usually stay on the equipment truck with all the lights and all the lighting, the stands and things that go with the lights. They're in charge of maintaining everything and making sure things doesn't, you know, break. If it breaks, they fix it. They have to make sure stuff doesn't get stolen off of the truck. You know, it doesn't end up in someone's pickup truck. And they're in charge of giving it out as well. Usually I work with either a key electrician or a lead electrician. So the DP tells the gaffer what the scene should look like. The gaffer tells the best boy, okay, I want, you know, a 5,000 watt lamp here and a 1,000 watt lamp there. And so then the gaffer tells the best boy. The best boy gets everything ready. The electricians come, get it off the truck, take it to the set, and rig it up. There's also a rigging gaffer. There's all the other kind of gaffers, but the main production crew will have a gaffer, a best boy on the truck, and a key electrician, electrician. The juicers, that's a industry term. They call them juicers, and they're not running electrical cords. They're running stingers. I mean, there's all kind of terminology that the lighting and grip people have. That, you know, if you don't know it and get on set, you're like, well, what kind of language are they talking? All right, so the gaffer's in charge of the lighting. The lighting, you know, gives exposure, brings light to the set. Grip takes light away. Therefore, we have the different department. The key grip is the kind of the equal to the gaffer. The key grip is in charge of the grip equipment or taking light away or rigging grips. So the key grip has the best boy grip. The grip truck is separate than the electrical truck. Normally on a big show, smaller shows, you know, they can all be on the same truck. But normally you would see a separate truck called a grip truck, and the person who's in charge of all the grip equipment, maintaining it, making sure it doesn't get stolen, handing it out, getting it back, cleaning it up, putting it, storing it, is the best boy grip. The main grip is called the key grip, and then the key grip has grips that work under them as well. And there might be So same thing. The gaffer and the key grip are told by the director of photography how he or she wants the scene to look, to be lit or to be shadowed. They go to their respective trucks, they get the equipment, they bring it on the set. Grips don't play with electrical equipment. They don't, you know, if something needs to be unplugged, the grip isn't doing that. That's the electrical job. And if something needs to be moved on to the set that isn't production design, that isn't art department, then it's the grip's job. Finally, down at the bottom, we have the dolly grip. This is a grip grips that are in charge of just the dolly. That includes maintaining it, security of it, operating of it, and stashing it, putting it back, stashing it on the truck, usually on the grip truck at the end of the day. All right, so there's the grip hierarchy, the lighting and grip hierarchy under the director of photography. So the camera department has its own hierarchy as well. You have the camera operator. Sometimes the DP and the camera operator are one and the same person. Some DPs like to get behind the camera and move and shoot it, and some DPs don't. They'd rather stand back with the monitor, with the director, watching the art that is being created. So the camera operator, that's their main job, is to operate the camera. Understand the operations of it, you know, lock it off when you're not using it. Don't walk away with it unlocked, because it can fall over. Camera operators has a first and a second assistant camera operator with them. The first assistant camera is the one that rides with the camera or that stays with the camera, racks focus, changes the lens. Anything that has to do with the camera operation, other than looking through it, is the first AC or the first assistant camera. Second assistant camera, usually they're the ones that they're also called the clapper or the loader. They're the ones that are running to the camera truck to get supplies that the camera needs, whether that's a new hard drive or a new magazine of film or a new battery. That's the second AC or the second assistant camera's job. They're also called the clapper because they're usually the ones that are in charge of the clapper is what it's called. The slate. And they're usually keeping a report as well as how much footage is being used, how much footage is left, what takes were done on what magazine or what hard drive. They're in charge of all the paperwork that goes along with operating the camera. Sometimes there's a third assistant camera if there's more than one camera on set, and normally on productions now they're more than multiple cameras, so there will be multiple camera operators, multiple first and second ACs, and so sometimes they'll have a third assistant that's acting as a runner for both of them, or is back in the camera truck doing maintenance on things. And a lot of times you'll see a camera intern, because the camera department is a very popular department for people to get into the film industry, so you'll see a lot of camera interns either from film school or working for one of the assistants, learning the ropes to be a camera operator and work their way up to DP. It's entry level, but there are ways to get in. So here's a nice little picture that illustrates the whole hierarchy. You see the camera operator behind the camera. He's actually, you know, holding on to the arm on the tripod that operates, you know, the pan and the tilt and the zoom. The person holding that little knob with the little white dial on it, that's the first AC, just like we saw in Living in Oblivion, the guy that was racking focus and he messed up. So the first AC is usually, other than the camera operator, is the only one that touches the camera. And like I said, changes lenses, cleans it, makes sure it's protected. And then you see the clapper in the back, or the second AC, or the clapper, the slash loader. They're all there in the shot, working together. I don't know if you remember our screening of Living in Oblivion, but the first line you hear in that movie is someone on a walkie-talkie saying, "Does anyone know where the camera truck is supposed to be parked? Or does anyone know where the camera truck is parked?" First line in the film. Usually the camera truck is one of the first to arrive as well. But, you know, again, you have to have parking for all these things. So this is inside a typical camera truck. They get a truck of their own because they tend to be clean trucks, meaning that there's a big wall of plastic inside the main door, because you don't want any dust, you don't want any dirt to get in the truck. They're also very highly secure, usually with alarms on it, because you have expensive equipment in a camera truck. I mean, a lens alone could be anywhere from $5,000 to $15,000 just for a single lens. Those big wide telephoto, those zoom lenses, those are crazy expensive. So the camera truck tends to usually have someone on it, either an intern or a third camera assistant, guarding the equipment, cleaning the equipment, maintaining the equipment, and shuffling it out to the set when camera equipment is needed. No eating and drinking on the camera truck, to say the least. They tend to be air conditioned, even though grips and electrical trucks aren't necessarily air conditioned. The camera trucks usually are, because that's usually where the film or the hard drives are stored as well. So all that stuff needs to be in a climate controlled environment. Comfortable place to be, camera truck. All right, so let's move on to our cameras. In the olden days, they were still shooting on film. Lately, other than some specialized things that I mentioned earlier, like Quentin Tarantino, things are shot digitally. But in the olden days, you actually had film. See, there's bottom left-hand corner, you see a camera assistant, probably a second AC, loading film into a magazine. That's a 400 magazine. Now, you would say, well, isn't he exposing the film? Yes. When you load film, you had to do it in either a black bag, which had three levels of layers on it, so no light would get through, or you had to do it in a dark room. Most camera trucks have a dark room on it, but basically you would load it in a black bag. So when you're a camera assistant learning how to load film, you have to do it with your eyes closed, because you have to be able to feel your way around and get it. And it's not just like slapping things together. You have to count sprockets. You have to make sure the exact amount of film is sticking out of the magazine to load it. Otherwise, when you load it into the camera, if your loop is too long, it'll waver and it won't get a good image. If it's too short, it'll break. So yeah, there's all science behind it. So for years and years and years and years, these were the two main cameras of the cinema industry, the professional industry. 35 millimeter, the bottom right one is the Aeroflex BL, and the top one is a Panavision Panaflex. You know, you've probably seen behind the scenes footage, and these are the two cameras you would usually see. And you know, there's representational of a 35 millimeter film frame. That's what you'd be running through these cameras. But we've graduated to all digital now. Cameras are shot with not stored on film. The information is stored on digital chips, whether it's an SD card or a miniature hard drive or a solid state SSD drive. That you just would slip it into the little magazine there and slip it into the camera, and that's how it's done nowadays. But you see the main companies, the Aeroflex and Panavision, they have adapted. They have come up with very high-end digital cameras. Enter this little company. A company is called RED. They made small, very compact, and relatively inexpensive for professional cameras, film cameras. These are digital. But they crashed into the market and did really well. Some relatively famous YouTubers jumped on the bandwagon and made some amazing footage that they were able to do because these cameras were so small. See, the footprint is so small. We're going to watch a clip of one particularly well done by a YouTuber named Devin Supertramp. He's since gone on to make professional films, but he got his start making these amazing films with these RED cameras.
Hey.
T'as rien à faire ici.
Allez, barre-toi.
Ha 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 ha!
The first one we're going to talk about, and these are all in the Director of Photography's Toolkit, and Director's Toolkit as well, is called Mastering Coverage. Okay. The second one we're going to discuss is Fluid Master. Now, these are the two basic ways that films are made, that films are shot, that directors, either they're trained or they know or they've watched enough films to know that to get a scene covered enough so I can take it to the editing room and have some flexibility in the editing room to either speed the scene up or slow the scene down or even change the direction of the scene, I have to get certain shots. All right. You can shoot everything in a wide shot. Films are done that way. There's one of my favorite directors, Kevin Smith, you know, when he made Clerks way back in the 90s. I mean, he just basically shot everything in a wide shot because, one, he didn't have very much money, so he couldn't get coverage. He couldn't do close-ups every now and then. But two, he was a beginning filmmaker, and so he didn't really understand or really didn't know how he could make things better or make things faster or slower or change scenes around by having coverage. Fortunately, you know, he wrote a great script and the film worked. But even in his later films, he realized that, the filmmaking process includes getting something called coverage. Okay, so getting coverage, basically you have a scene, let's example here, of two people sitting at a table talking to each other. You would get a wide shot, which is B, down at the bottom, which is the two people talking. You shoot the entire scene in that shot. All right. So you get them doing all their dialogue in that B shot, which is the B camera in the middle. Okay. And then you would move the camera because you only have one camera. Maybe you have three. If you have three cameras, that's great. But typically you'll have one camera. So you would move the camera to the A position and shoot a close up of the person on the right. And you do the whole scene that way as well. And the person who's not on camera still acts because they need to have someone to react to off camera. And then when you finish that, you move the camera over to C position and you shoot the other person, the whole scene. So you've got the scene covered three different ways. And now you can take it to the editing room and you can cut between those three shots. And like I said, you can speed it up, slow it down. Sometimes you would decide to, I'm just going to keep it in a wide shot. It works. But if you need to pick up the pacing, or someone messed up a line in the close-up, or someone messed up a line in the wide shot, then you would have to cut it. It's just like in Living in Oblivion, where he wanted to get that shot in one take, right? That he wanted those two ladies, the mom talking to the daughter, and they just kept messing up. But he wanted it in one take. And their solution was to break the scene up and do some coverage of it. So I have here coverage would be establishing shot, you know, the room that they're in, a wide shot, which is the two sitting there, medium shots, you could do medium shots from the waist up, close-ups, which are just the face, extreme close-ups, which is like pieces of the face, or you could do these over-the-shoulder two shots, all right? And the movement available would be either pans between the two of them, or tilt up from the table, or their hands to their face and tilt down. You could dolly in, you could pedestal up, or you can even have jib arm and do that. But that's your master in coverage, all right? So Film School 101, you learn how to shoot master in coverage. And like I said, you shoot it three times, at least three times, for two people, and you get the wide shot, the coverage of both.
Janie, today I quit my job. And then I told my boss to go fuck himself, and then I blackmailed him for almost $60,000. Pass the asparagus.
Your father seems to think this kind of behavior is something to be proud of.
And your mother seems to prefer that I go through life like a fucking prisoner while she keeps my dick in a mason jar under the sink.
How dare you speak to me that way in front of her? And I marvel that you can be so contemptuous of me on the same day that you lose your job.
I didn't lose it. It's not like, whoops, where'd my job go? I quit. Someone pass the asparagus.
Oh, and I want to thank you for putting me under the added pressure of being the sole breadwinner now.
I already have a job.
No, don't give a second thought as to who's going to pay the mortgage. We'll just leave it all up to Carolyn. You mean you're going to take care of everything now, Carolyn? Yes, I don't mind. I really don't. You mean everything? You don't mind having the sole responsibility? Your husband feels he can just quit his job and you don't...
Will someone who's please gonna pay the ask me now? The
okay,
fucking
guys,
asparagus?
I'm not going to be a part of this.
Shut up!
Mad for you.
am sick and tired of being treated like I don't exist. You two do whatever you want to do, whenever you want to do it, and I don't complain. All I want
is the same... Oh, you don't complain? Oh, please, excuse me. I must be psychotic then. If you don't complain, what is this? Yeah, let's bring in the laugh meter and see how loud it gets on that one. You don't complain.
Don't interrupt me, honey. And another thing. From now on, we're going to alternate our dinner music because, frankly, and I don't think I'm alone here, I'm really tired of this Lawrence Welk shit.
In that scene, right, this was made by Sam Mendes, who's, you know, wasn't an amateur filmmaker at the time. But the director wanted a, you know, that everything about that scene is lulling you into this, oh, this is gonna be a nice scene, candlelit, nice music, handsome people having a nice dinner together. It's not gonna turn into the, you know, the SHIT show that it turns into. He sucker punches you basically in this scene. And the way he shot it, the wide shot, close up coverage, is another key that he's saying, this is, you think this is your typical family having a typical dinner, and then it turns not to be. Now, he could have had a moving camera in there, a steady cam, like circling the three of them. You know, he could have had a jib arm fly in and get close-ups of all. He could have done all kinds of movement or a shaky cam running between the two, but that wasn't what he wanted for the scene, the theme and the tempo and the feeling, the atmosphere of the scene to be. He wanted you to think that this was going to be a nice scene. So it's brilliant filmmaking. And again, basic filmmaking, coverage, close up. So let's go to the Fluid Master now, which is basically in a single take. You get everything done in one take, just like Living in Oblivion. He wanted that one shot of those two, the mom and the daughter sitting there. You get the entire scene in one shot, and we've seen what happens from that film. One person messes up a line, boom comes into the shot, guy racks focus. Truck on the street messes it up. You have to do the whole thing over again, which is why one take, these Fluid Masters, are really hard, because you have to choreograph the camera, the crew, lighting, talent, dolly, sound. Everything has to be choreographed perfectly because you only have one shot to get it. Now, you know, you don't get it one shot. You do multiple takes, but you know, it costs money, and it costs creative input as well, because as people have to do it multiple times, they may lose some spark. These are all the things you have to choreograph. Your dolly, your Steadicam makes moving the camera a lot easier nowadays than before. But just seeing, why would anyone go through all the trouble of doing that? Well, it's a directorial choice. You know, they want to show off the acting chops and the directing chops, and these things are hard to do. When you see a Fluid Master in a film, it's pretty impressive, because you think, wow, they had to choreograph all those elements, and how many times did they have to do it before it messed up? I have an amazing Fluid Master I'm going to show you now from a film called Children of Men, and when I first saw it, I could not figure out how they did it.
He always snored.
Where are we?
Canterbury. We're close.
Anyone know if there's a hotel around here?
What?
Julian promised me a little bit of action.
You still like it in the afternoon?
So what'd you do? Rob a train? Blow up a building?
Leave the girl alone. You told me he was suave. One gets a drunk.
He's suave. Should have seen him in the old days when he was a real activist.
You were the activist. I just wanted to get laid.
One time, the police came to throw us out of our squat, and Theo invited them up for coffee to negotiate, only the coffee was spiked with ketamine.
No, you didn't, did you?
Oh, fuck off. You've got to be kidding.
You know how many people I've tried this with? You'll be happy to know, out of the hundreds, you are still the only one.
I'm not doing it.
Yes, you are.
No, I'm not.
Yes,
the car's moving too
much. Yes, you are. Mm-hmm. You are. Right?
Hilarious. No, wait. Okay. Do it again. Julian, that's disgusting. Look out!
Jesus!
Go. Fuck. Go, we're gonna make it. Come on, we're gonna
make
it.
I'm not gonna make it!
Back up now!
Jesus!
Go!
What?
Okay, so if you can figure out how they did that, congrats to you. Well, I'll give you a hint. The car comes apart. You see the camera moving in this car. Like, we're inside the car, and you know, cars don't have very much room. But basically, the car was it comes apart. So the camera was able to get in there, get out. And that was one take. So everything from the blood and the screaming and all this stuff that happens outside, the burning car, that's all one take. I never found out how many takes they had to do to get it, but it's an amazing shot, an amazing the directorial choice, very brave, very bold. And, you know, again, he had to go to the DP and say, I want to get this whole scene in one shot. He's like, we're in a car. How are we going to move the camera in and out of the car? There's a way. All right, so that's it for today. A little bit of follow-up. Be sure to check Blackboard for the quiz, the cinematography quiz. It'll be like last week, 5 questions. Send your responses to me via course messages. Don't text them, please. So use the course message. You can either type them in a message or, you know, attach it as a Word file. Doesn't matter to me. And this video for this lecture and this quiz will only be on Blackboard until 10 o'clock tonight. So what you're watching now, it's going to go away at 10. Wash your hands. Bye.